Hi, g'day, Joey here. Back to Blues Riffs for Guitar by Mark Michaels. It's lick number 76. And in this one, we get to practise a moderately difficult 16th run. Always good practice to do our 16ths. This is a particularly difficult sort of pattern, so I'll talk a bit about that. And I've coupled it with a nice Latin beat from my Digitech Trio, so very nice backing track. So you would have heard a bit of that at the start. So tabs up. So these are the tabs straight out of the book. So you got it rest for A7, and we're going to fill that in later. And then on the G7, you got this 16th pattern. So you got this pattern of three notes repeating, and it repeats over to a second bar. What I'll do now is actually try and get the two bars side by side so you can see the whole pattern from start to finish, yeah? Now, what makes a pattern like this difficult, and sometimes you see this in fast eighth runs where you have three eighths in a row. So something like I'm a Believer from the Monkees, you got, yeah? So what's happened there is you got three notes repeating, and then by the time you get to the third beat, the accent now has fallen on a different note, yeah? Because three doesn't go into four. So as you keep repeating the three note riff, the accents change. And so that can mess with your head sometimes. It especially messes with your head when you're doing 16ths across two bars like this one. Because you're sort of trying to work out where you are. And, if you're around my level of playing, the first time you do this, you will find it quite difficult to work out where you are exactly, whether you're still where you're meant to be. And the reason why that happens is because there's a tendency to rush it. So that you end up doing grace notes rather than actual 16ths. So watch out for that. I know I'm guilty of that. So the backing track I've done at the end is 97 beats per minute. It is a wonderful tempo to practice these 16ths, to make it a challenge, but to it's a tempo where you can hear and feel each 16th. I think that's important. So you're not rushing through it, you're really wanting to hear each of those 16ths, yeah? So that's very important. Rather than like that hammer-on, that must be 16. Now, one way I have of at least initially making sure I'm spot on tempo, spot on beat, is that, yeah, make sure that that second hammer on, you can see, is hitting the second beat. So that hammer on the fifth, that D note, should be hitting the second beat. So you want to, and that's a good way to gauge yourself early on, yeah? Yeah, so really feel like you're accenting that hammer-on. Another thing I'm doing is, even though I start with a downstroke, the rest, every time I hit that C note on the return, I'm doing an upstroke. So, and I keep that up all the way, even if I hit it on the first beat, or on a beat. I'm going to keep that because it means you have minimal movement between that F note and the C note. Yes, I start with a downstroke and then always do an upstroke. Yeah, all right. So as I said, so one good way to gauge that you're keeping correct tempo is to make sure that that second hammer-on hits that D note on the second beat, and then as you keep going, make sure that F note is hitting the third beat. So if you can do that early on, and then you'll sort of lose track of where you are after that, but if you can at least hit those two notes on beat, that will help you maintain a good tempo right throughout. Now, what you're also wanting to do, and this becomes, you know, trickier to think about, because, you know, the notes are flying by, but so by the time you get to the fourth beat, you are starting, you're back to the cycle, the start of the cycle, by hitting that C note. So every three beats, you do four cycles, and that gets you back to starting the cycle on a beat again. Right there. So as you practice this, you'll gradually get to feel that, okay, I'm back on a beat there, and then you want to do another four cycles. And it's at that next cycle where you're hitting the beat again. This time we're on that next bar, we're on up to the third beat, you're hitting that C note again on beat, and then it changes, so this is tricky. So, as you practice this more, you'll get to feel that, okay, you're starting the cycle again on beat, and then you want to do four more of these. Yeah, you'll start to feel that, yeah, but you got to take it from me. So, look, I was hopeless when I first started practicing this, and this is one reason why. If you're thinking, why should I listen to a mediocre guitarist tell me how to play this? It is because I've worked out a way that it works for me to get on top of it, and I've gone from being hopeless with it to being, you know, very, very, very close to nailing it every time. I still make mistakes, don't get me wrong, but I'm very close to nailing it. So I'm showing you how I worked out the timing that helped me. And for any other guitarist around my standard of playing who find this a challenge initially, you can nail this as well. And the thing is, this pattern, you'll come across it many times. As I said, you played in that monkey song, I'm a Believer, in eighths. But the pattern of 3/8 or 3/16, where the accent's changing every beat, you'll come across that a lot, yeah? Okay, so let me now put up the extras. So I've added extras. So we essentially have two bars of A7, two bars of G7, two bars of D7, then repeat. So I'm doing a cycle of six bars, just repeating over and over. We're in the key of D. By the way, we're in straight eighths. So this is the first time I've done straight eighths for a very, very long time, because we usually do swung eighths. And the reason why I'm forced to do straight eighths is because when you have a run of 16ths like that, clearly, this is a straight eighths beat, yeah? Okay, so let's do the extras. So from bar one, I'll now put up each of the bars that I'm doing. I'll start off with this, just this slide from the 5th to the 7th fret, yeah? To hold for two beats. And then another little run of 16ths. Which basically mimics what we're already doing. So I'm incorporating into another bar with a different chord and a different position. End on a quarter note, then back up a string. End on a quarter note. Put this nice slide, just kill it on the G note, because we're still in the A7. And then we've got. To finish up that D7. Holding that note for two notes, and then I've added extras after that. I haven't done tabs after this, but what I do here, the A7's coming up, and you'll hear this in the backing track. I have a rest on that beat, then I, you know, go one. Yeah, holding that for the rest of that bar of A7. Yeah. Another rest. Another rest on the G7. Yeah. Another rest. Off-road into sort of extend the backing track a bit with that the very nice backing track that I've done. Why don't we jump to the backing track? It is tricky, all right? Don't get me wrong, but hopefully that will help you. Okay, so the backing track. Hope you enjoyed that. Look, I've improved from being hopeless at this to getting close to doing it. Okay. All right. Thanks for watching. See you next time. Bye bye.